text, job cast by Indeed. Talk like a boss. How to communicate assertively in the job search. Brandy Warwas, job seeker experience, Indeed.
When I see the word assertive, what comes to mind? If it's someone yelling commands at their coworkers, then you're in for a big surprise. In reality, assertiveness allows you to stand up for your rights while still being mindful of the rights and feelings of others. If you can master assertive communication, there are big benefits for your career and likely for other parts of your life too. Stick around until the end of this workshop for all of our expert tips.
Learning objectives.
Here's what we'll cover in this workshop. First, the difference between assertive and aggressive communication. Why societal pressures make it harder for women to be assertive. Verbal, visual, and vocal methods of assertive communication. And examples of how to communicate assertively in your job search and in the workplace. I'm excited to introduce our guest speaker today, Emilie Aries. Emilie is a speaker, podcast host, author, and the founder and CEO of Bossed Up, an award-winning personal and professional development community where she helps women craft happy, healthy, and sustainable career paths.
Text. The information presented in this webinar is provided as a courtesy, and any views and opinions expressed do not necessarily reflect the official policy or position of Indeed. It does not represent a forecast, prediction, or other indication of future market or economic performance and should not be relied upon as such purposes. Indeed is not a career or legal advisor and does not guarantee job interviews or offers.
And that's me, Brandy Warwas. I'm a manager on Indeed's Job Seeker Experience team. We're responsible for creating helpful resources, like this Jobcast, for our users, like you. Take it away, Emilie.
Thanks so much, Brandy, and hello and happy International Women's Day, everybody. I'm so delighted to dive into this topic with y'all. This is by far my most popular topic that I speak on, podcast about, and have written extensively about on my blog and in my book, Bossed Up, A Grown Woman's Guide to Getting Your Shit Together. If you're interested in keeping up with me, I hope we can continue to be in conversation about this topic and many more over at bossedup.org. So first, let's jump right in. What are we even talking about when we say assertive?
Text, is it assertive or aggressive?
In everyday colloquial speech, we often use the words assertive and aggressive interchangeably, as though they're synonyms, when in fact, there are fundamental structural differences to being assertive versus being aggressive. This is not widely understood, but absolutely key in ensuring that everyone is equally lauded for their leadership style, leadership actions, and leadership behaviors. So let's take a look at the definitions together. These definitions were first presented to me by my former college professor, Barbara Tannenbaum at Brown University. She's a professor of persuasive communication, and she taught me that being assertive means being forthright about your wants and needs while still considering the rights, needs, and wants of others. In other words, when I'm being assertive, I'm sharing what I think is best. I'm sharing what I need, but I'm keeping the door open to hearing from others. It's by definition more of a two-way dialogue as opposed to more of a one-way proclamation. That's what leads us to the aggressive territory. When I'm being aggressive, regardless of intent, because let's be real, we've all been aggressive, whether we've intended to be or not, and I'm sure we'll all be aggressive again sometime in the future, I'm doing whatever's in my own best interest without considering the rights, needs, feelings, or desires of other people. And by the way, sometimes we can be aggressive in a way that looks very nice. I'm talking to you Midwesterners and Southerners who have mastered the art of Minnesota nice or of Southern hospitality that can sometimes be a little bit aggressive in a passive aggressive way. But keep in mind, the key difference here is when I'm being assertive, there's two-way dialogue. When I'm being aggressive, it's a one-way proclamation. Has anyone here ever been on the receiving end of a sticky note from a roommate or an office mate? They're getting their message across. They're letting you know what their wants, needs, and desires are. but they're not really sticking around to hear from you, are they? That's a perfect example of what can seem very innocuous, but what is in fact quite passive aggressive. So why does this matter so much? Turns out being assertive, not aggressive, has huge benefits. Even though it can be difficult to speak your mind, to get your voice across, to speak up when you see something wrong going down, there are enormous personal and professional benefits of assertive communication.
Title: Benefits of Assertiveness.
First of all, personally speaking, assertiveness is what helps us draw healthy boundaries. Now, this is just as relevant with our personal relationships as it is with our professional ones. I don't know if anyone here has ever made a call to a mother-in-law telling her, "I'm sorry, we can't get together for the holidays this year," or "I'm sorry, we're going to be headed to my parents for the holidays this year." But those kinds of everyday negotiations with our loved ones absolutely requires being assertive. Not aggressive, ideally, but being assertive can help us draw the healthy boundaries that we all need to succeed. Similarly, it helps us actually reduce chronic anxiety, which is a little counterintuitive, but let me explain here. Even though having an assertive conversation can really get your heart pumping and your palms a little sweaty in real time because, it is nerve-wracking to speak up for yourself and demand respect and demand whatever it is that you need. But contrast that acute temporary form of stress with the more chronic kind of stress that goes on and on and on if you feel like a doormat being walked all over every single day in a toxic workplace or in a toxic relationship where you feel like you have no voice. I've been there before. And I remember just how chronically stressful and anxiety-inducing that experience can be. So simply knowing how to assert yourself while temporarily stressful can actually enable you to reduce overall chronic anxiety in the course of your life. Now, there are also big professional benefits to being assertive as well. Women who demonstrate the ability to be assertive are seen by their professional peers as having executive presence. Executive presence is one of those very je ne sais quoi qualities that's really hard to pin down. But what it's all about is other people's perception of your leadership capacity. So whether you are a CEO or an intern, your colleagues will look to you and decide, can she take on more? Can she lead this project? I think she has what it takes to get to the next level. If you're looking to display more executive presence, we have to combat our socialized, intrinsic, often lifelong socialization to perfect, perform, and please everyone else around us, to offer service with a smile, to be everything to everyone at all times, and instead balance that with moments of assertiveness. I'm not saying we should pick every battle and we should be assertive with every conversation at every moment, at every time, but research does show that it's women who know when to turn it on and turn it off, who reap the biggest professional rewards, who are seen as someone who can have tough conversations when necessary, who can handle a tricky client, who can stand up and say, no, this project is headed in the wrong direction and we need to get it back on course. And it's those women who are seen as having executive presence who end up getting more promotions. So personally and professionally, honing your assertive communication is really important, but for women in the world, it is really difficult.
Text: Why is assertiveness more difficult as a woman?
And spoiler alert, it's not us. This is not a women's issue in that this is not our problem. The problem is how the world views assertive women. For over 30 years now, as long as social scientists have been measuring it, they find that both men and women deem assertive women less likable. Ooh, who here has run into that challenge over the course of their career? I feel like anyone who's ever been called bossy or maybe even another B word knows how tricky it can feel, almost like you're tap dancing on a tightrope, trying to be taken seriously by being assertive, but like not being overbearing or a nag or shrill or harsh. And that is such an exhausting tap dance. It's a challenge that we shouldn't have to navigate, but it's one that is seeped in historic, age-old stereotypes about what it means to be a good woman, being kind, helpful, caring, sweet, and nurturing. And that is very different than what we deem societally what it takes to be a leader.
The Leadership Double Bind. Source: How Women Manage the Gendered Norms of Leadership, Harvard Business Review, November 2018.
So for instance, this mismatch between conventionally feminine qualities and qualities deemed necessary for leadership, including being able to stand up and make your voice heard assertively, puts female leaders in a double bind. Honestly, this is the issue that I want to devote my career to. This is what we talk about and think about and work on every single day at Bossed Up. And it's confounding because, as I mentioned, both women and men hold these biases that are extremely unconscious, with no malintent, with no conscious, plot against women leaders. It can just be difficult to be an assertive woman who's able to navigate this kind of unconscious bias, whereby we have to be assertive to get the job done, but we also have to be sweet, and we have to be nice, and we have to be pleasant, and it's exhausting. So this International Women's Day and this Women's History Month in particular, let's first of all raise awareness that this is a global problem. This is a multifaceted problem, and it gets even more complicated when you look at the data around how this relates to women of different ages, races, along the gender spectrum, class, geography. There are a million different biases that we're up against, and especially being a woman of color, being assertive, you run into all kinds of unconscious bias that white women, while this is difficult enough, do not have to deal with. So intersectionality can be a really helpful framework. I know Brandy's sharing a couple great resources on Indeed. We have a couple great podcasts that I've podcasted and written at Bossed Up, all about understanding the fundamentals of intersectionality. But what this really requires is an acknowledgement that the lived experiences of all women are not the same. We are not operating in a vacuum where only one kind of unconscious bias is being labeled upon us at once. And the tightrope tap dance gets a lot trickier when you've got a juggling act on top of it. For example, young women in the workforce, when they're being assertive, might run into patronizing feedback like, oh, sweetie, don't worry your pretty little head about that. And that's something that I've experienced firsthand as a young woman in the workforce. And I think I've since grown out of that stage in my life. But then I always say a woman is only too young to be a leader until she's too old or deemed too old by society to be a leader, because women who are more seasoned and experienced in their careers are more likely to run into, oh, don't be such a nag, or don't be so harping or so, maternalistic when it comes to how you're asking people to do things for you or how you're leading your team. And again, if we bring a framework of intersectionality, this simply allows us to acknowledge that not every woman's experience of this looks the same. It gets more complicated, it is nuanced, and that is why we need to listen to women and believe women when they share their lived experiences. So I'm not here to be a Debbie Downer. I'm not here to just share the bad news, which is that our status quo is still very much seeped in forms of unconscious bias and sexism that we have a lot of work to and a lot of room to improve upon. I'm here to share some practical, tactical, research-based tips for how to navigate this mess. My absolute favorite strategy that comes out of some interesting research around intent then content is a little psychological hack to bring to your everyday speech that can help reverse this trend. It can help us sort of inoculate ourselves against other people's unconscious discomfort with assertive women. Now, just to be clear, I'm not saying we should do this every single time we speak up assertively, but when it really matters to you, like when you're asking for a raise or a promotion or you're negotiating on the job search, you want to use every tool in the toolbox. So here's a quick communication tool that can help you get your message across assertively, but be more likely to go over well. And here's the strategy. You want to lead with intent, which explains why you're about to ask for whatever it is that you're about to ask for. Before getting to your assertive content, whatever it is that you're asking for. Now, in our minds, we rationally do the opposite. We think logically, like something along the lines of, hey, Brandy, would you turn off the light so that everybody in the room can see the video I'm about to play? And if I'm being charitable, I'll explain to Brandy why I want her to turn off the lights. But the first thing I think is what I need Brandy to do for me. Now, reverse that and you'll get, hey, Brandy, I want to make sure everyone can see the video I'm about to play. Would you mind turning off the lights? Or can you turn off the lights? Same speech, but reversed order. Let's look through a couple more examples. Let's say you are interviewing and in the middle of your interview, a job hiring manager asks you what your preferred salary range is. I know we all run into this way too often in the job search, and this is a very confounding situation. So let's say you reply with this. I'm not comfortable discussing salary at this early stage of the interview, as I want to make sure we're a good fit for each other first. That's a pretty assertive refusal to answer the question, which, by the way, I am here for. I don't think anyone should feel pressured into naming their own salary. However, if we reverse the order, it sounds a little different. You know, I want to make sure we're a good fit for each other first, so I'm not comfortable discussing salary at this early stage of the interview process just yet. Do you hear the difference? It's really subtle, but it can help. And it really is only something to think about when you're in a really high stakes conversation and you want to use every tool in the toolbox. Let's look at another example where you've got to ask a colleague or you've got to break some bad news to a colleague. Hey, we may need the team to work overtime this week because I want to make sure we're sticking to the deadline on this project. Now, when I tell my colleague John that we may need the team to work overtime this week, what do you think happens to John's body? When he hears the word overtime, his body floods with the stress hormone cortisol. He is ready to fight or flight. He is already tuned out from the rest of the sentence. And it goes into like that Charlie Brown adult speak of wah, 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 wah. And John is getting ready to be defensive because he just got some bad news dropped on him. And he's feeling sidelined, right? Or blindsided. So when you have to break some bad news to people, we're not saying to sugarcoat it, and we're not saying to beat around the bush. We're simply saying to add contextual explanation up front instead of on the back end. So let's see if I ask John in this way. Hey, John, I want to make sure we're sticking to the deadline on this project, so we may need the team to work overtime this week. Again, same words, different order, slightly different impact. Now, if you've got a really aggressive colleague, or you've got a really hostile sister-in-law, let me just acknowledge that like nothing you do to perfect your speech is going to make sure that someone who's just on a mission to be a jerk is going to like reverse their trend. However, you want to know that, you know, you've got some options for how to be strategically communicating when the stakes are high. Let's walk through a few more examples on the job search that you might run into. So when I'm deciding whether to accept a job offer and I'm trying to buy myself some more time, that requires a really assertive comeback to someone who's on the phone saying, hey, Emily, here's the job. Will you take it? It's very tempting to just say, sure. But that's not really doing what's in your best interest, is it? You deserve time to think about this. So here's an assertive way to lead with intent and then content to ask for more time. As you can imagine, this is an important decision, and I really want to make it with care. Can you send me the details in writing, and let's sync back at the end of the week to discuss it? That way, I'm putting my asks out there. I'm asking for time to think about this. I'm asking for the details of the offer in writing, which is well within my rights as a job seeker. And I'm basically refusing to just say yes, which is what they want us to do, to just solve the problem for them. If you're going to especially negotiate and ask for more money, you've got to be able to be assertive and speak up on your own behalf. And this is one way to do so while leading with intent. Let's say you've got something that just came up and you have to reschedule a really important interview that you were super looking forward to. Again, breaking bad news like this to someone whose opinion about you you really care about is never easy. But let's use that intent and then content strategy here and see how it sounds. You know, I want to be sure to give you my full undivided attention during our interview. And I just learned I have a conflict at our scheduled time. Would you be available to reschedule for any other day this coming week? Notice we're providing contextual information in the form of intent, but we're not apologizing. We're not over-explaining. We're not saying what came up. You don't need to, you know, soften your assertive statement with apologies and over-explanation. Simply giving a little bit of intent up front before getting to the point and getting right to your assertive content can really go very far. Finally, let's talk about the most assertive conversation we might ever have, which is asking for more money. Let's take this into the negotiation example here to hear how it sounds to lead with intent, then content. You know, I'm so excited to join your team, and I want to make this a long-term career move, as I'm confident I'll be able to devote many years to this company. But to do that, I'm looking for a starting salary of $72,000. Is that a number we could move forward on? I'm not saying, please, please, pretty, please. I'm not, you know, expressing all of my nervousness in the form of apology, like, sorry, I can't take this offer as it stands. I'm simply saying, here's my goal for us to come together, to have a long-term relationship in the form of this employee-employer relationship. And then I'm putting the number out there that I'm asking for and asking without apology. So one more example here, and then we're going to break this down even further. Let's say you're asking a question during an interview, which can always be a little nerve-wracking, especially if the hiring manager doesn't give you a chance to ask questions. You've really got to speak up and interject and jump right in. So let's say I've got a clarifying question that's kind of a deal breaker I want to ask. Here's how that might go. I want to make sure we're on the same page about long-term growth potential. You hear that? That's intent. Why I'm about to ask what I'm about to ask. Can you tell me more about your vision for this department in the coming 2 to 5 years? If I skip to the assertive content and say, hey, hiring manager, can you tell me more about your vision for this department in the coming 2 to 5 years? They're not going to have a clear sense of why I'm asking. They might start making up a story in their own minds, like, oh, why is she leaving in 2 to 5 years? Is she trying to see if I'm smart? Is she trying to see how familiar I am with her department? Is she putting me on the spot? If you don't explicitly share your why behind your what, the person listening to you is going to make up their own explanation and their own counter narrative in their mind about why it is that you're asking. And that can be really, I don't know, risky. So my goal here is for you to control the message, for you to be in the driver's seat when it comes to being assertive here by leading with your intent, so that the person listening to you doesn't make up their own story as to why you're asking for what it is that you're asking for. All right, one quick note before we move further. Speaking up on your own behalf assertively is always challenging. It just risks looking selfish in a society that still thinks women who just ask for equal treatment are selfish, right? That can be a really tricky thing to navigate. So here's an alternative to think about.
Title, A Note on Allyship. It's almost always easier to speak up on behalf of someone else than yourself.
Speaking up assertively on behalf of others is a wonderful way to practice assertive communication in action. It might look like amplifying underheard voices in your office, giving credit where credit is due, passing the mic by saying, you know, Brandy, you're an expert in this. Why don't you chime in here? Or just calling out and calling in your colleagues when you hear something whack go down that you can't sit idly by and say nothing about. So it's one thing to speak up on your own behalf. It's another thing to speak up on behalf of others, and it's a great way to practice. Did you want to chime in, Brandy?
Yeah, I think that this is so important, especially for anyone who manages people. You know, a good manager should be advocating for their team and also protecting their time and boundaries. So this is a really good way to do that.
I love that point. And, you know, it's a good reminder that, again, because being assertive for women and other marginalized groups feels so high stakes and so nerve-wracking in the workplace, If you've got a manager who is clearly not comfortable with being assertive, we have to do what we can to empower our managers to be assertive on our behalf. Otherwise, what happens, which is far too common an experience in so many companies that I work with, is everybody's manager overcommits and then everybody feels under the gun with an unrealistic amount of work to do in a way too short time period. And that literally stems from a lack of boundary setting all the way up and down the food chain. So it's a really great point, Brandy.
Text, let's talk style.
I want to talk a little bit about how our style influences assertive versus aggressive impressions that people get about us. So if you've been thinking to yourself or for everyone who's been sharing in comments, yeah, but the tone of voice that you said that in is what sounds assertive, or your body language seems really aggressive, or anyone here who's ever been told, you know, your facial expressions are kind of hostile. I'm here to tell you that, first of all, assertive or aggressive is not determined by style. As we discussed right at the top, whether you're being assertive or aggressive has to do with whose rights are being respected. Keep that in mind. That being said, the messages that other people hear from us are heavily influenced by nonverbal communication. This is a pretty old study, but it has lasted over the years because many researchers have found that the vocal tone, the sound of one's voice, and our body language, like all the hand gestures that I like to speak with, or even your facial expressions, heavily influence how other people perceive your message.
Verbal, words, 7%. Visual, body, 55%. Vocal, tone, 38%. Source, silent messages. Implicit communication of emotions and attitudes. Albert Mehrabian, 1981.
In fact, the words that we choose to use, as much as I've been talking about that, makes up only 7% or so of how other people perceive us. So if we want to be seen as very assertive, we have to think about how I can align my nonverbal communication with my assertive communication, like verbal communication. Now, before we go any further, let me quickly say that I am not here to police anyone's speech. The way you talk is A-okay. This is not a primer on the right way to talk or the only way to speak professionally. In fact, I think minority communities in majority environments know better than anyone the power of code switching, which is all about knowing how to adjust your style to your audience, right? So anyone who's grown up in a household that speaks more than one language knows the way I speak with my mamita might not sound exactly like the way I speak with my staff in the office. So thinking about making adjustments should always come from an empowered place of choice. These are options I want to share with you that are best practices for coming across as assertively as possible. But that does not always serve your goal. If your goal is to get out of a speeding ticket, then do not do anything I'm about to share with you, because that is an awful time to be assertive. In fact, you would be better off being quite demure and, you know, placating in an environment like that. So what I'm about to share with you is choices to make if you want to up your assertiveness. Let's start with verbal assertiveness. Oftentimes, we all have filler words like, you know, whatever it is that you have. We all have different filler words that are simply verbalizations that our brains make when we're trying to buy ourselves time to think. So some of my favorite filler words are like, and you know, and right. I had a bad habit of ending all of my sentences with right, just to get that little verbal check-in from my audiences back in the pre-COVID era when I was doing a lot of keynote speaking at conferences and companies in person across the United States. Instead of relying on filler words to buy yourself time to think, especially if you're interviewing and you're listening intently to the question that you get, and then before you answer that question, you say, yeah, that's a really great question, definitely. So like, I guess I would approach it from this perspective, and then you launch in to your answer. That was all filler, right? That was all meaningless filler because you're trying to buy time to think. Instead, what would it feel like to be asked a question, to sit back thoughtfully, take a breath, pause, take the time you need to think, and then respond thoughtfully. You are more likely to be seen as pensive and thoughtful and comfortable with a little bit of silence, as opposed to really nervous and over-talking and filling every single moment with speech, which can backfire in terms of being seen as calm, cool, and collected. Similarly, sometimes when we're speaking up assertively, we qualify our speech. I'm sorry, but I have a question. That's an example of a qualifier. Basically, what you're saying is what I'm about to say might not be important. For instance, you might raise your hand in a meeting and say, this might, you know, be out of the box, or this might be kind of off topic. So just let me know if you want me to put this in the parking lot and we can talk about it later. But here's my idea. Or you might say, you know, this is kind of crazy and half-baked idea, but here's what I would contribute to this conversation. That is an unconscious habit that too many of us have that essentially diminishes what we're about to say. Now, listen, if you are an expert giving under oath testimony in the courtroom and you need to express doubt in what it is that you're about to say, fine, qualify away all day. But if this becomes an unconscious habit where you present your ideas as just like maybe, I don't know, some kind of maybe considerations, this thing can become a sort of way of chopping yourself off at the knee before you take your first step. An alternative is just to say your idea. I think we're headed in the wrong direction. I feel like we need to revisit the data on this, and simply speaking up and getting right to the point. And if getting right to the point, like, no way, that's a terrible idea, feels way too assertive, I think and I feel are great shorter warm-ups to get you there, as opposed to I might think sort of differently on this. You know, getting to your point can really help you give an assertive impression. Finally, one of the most assertive conversations we'll ever have is a conversation about saying no. That's why it's the subject of my TED Talk, The Power of No, which is all about how difficult it can be to just say no, especially if we're women in this world. As a result, so many of us apologize our way to no. We over-explain, we stumble, we say, I'm so sorry I can't make it to your birthday party. I have this root canal that's been overscheduled and I really have to deal with this thing. And we over-explain and we apologize away to get to no, when in fact we could imagine ourselves like a gymnast flying off the balance beam and sticking her landing and saying, I can't make it to her birthday party, to your birthday party on Friday. Can I take you out to lunch next week to make up for it? Now, of course, saying no to your friend's birthday party is always easier than saying no to your boss's request. But the same ideology applies. Instead of over-explaining, how can we get to the point succinctly and provide alternatives? Like, you know, I'm at capacity right now, but I'm happy to take this priority on if you'd like me to move other things off my plate. Let's look at my priorities together. Again, easier said than done, but something to keep in mind.
Yeah, Emily, I just want to jump in here. And going back to the pause, think, answer, just want to tell everyone, and remember this for your interviews, you know, if the interviewer asks a question and you don't have an answer ready to go, you know, just take a second before responding. Now, make sure your face doesn't look like a deer in headlights so they don't think that you're freezing, but just that you're being thoughtful in your response, and it should make a big difference.
Totally. And that's such a good precursor to what we're going to talk about next, which is body language. Because like you said, your nonverbals, facially or body-wise, can tell a big part of the story. Amy Cuddy is a researcher from Harvard, and maybe you've heard her very popular TED Talk about power poses or have read her book Presence. But what she and her research team found is that in nature, whether we're talking about a king cobra flaring its neck or a gorilla pounding its chest or a human being winning a race and crossing the finish line, we animals take up more space when we're feeling powerful. It's innate to our physiology. But the most fascinating part of her research is that you can actually reverse engineer your way to feeling more powerful by acting the way you want to feel. So if we naturally sit back and kind of like put our feet up on our desk when we're feeling especially accomplished or proud, studies show that taking up space and similarly striking your favorite power pose, like any of these, can actually have a physiological effect where you feel more powerful if you look more powerful.
Title: Visual Assertiveness. Classic power poses. A person stands with their arms in the air. A person stands with their hands on their hips. A man leans back as he sits with one arm on the back of the chair. A person leans on a table with their palms flat.
Other people's perceptions track in a similar fashion. When I'm taking up more space, like the assuming the Wonder Woman position, which is one of my favorites, other people are likely to perceive me as feeling more confident and powerful, and I'm more likely to perceive myself as feeling more confident and powerful too. There's similar fascinating research on a phenomenon called the facial feedback loop that says if you smile, you actually feel happier. So again, you can sort of reverse engineer your way to feeling how you want to feel by striking the pose that your body would normally take when you're doing so. So the findings of her research really tell us to strike a power pose for about 2 minutes, preferably, before you have your next nerve-wracking interview or phone call or presentation to make, and you can actually reverse engineer your way to the confidence that you want to bring to that conversation. Now, the last thing I'll say about this is let's talk about where gender fits into all of this. Ladies who are listening right now, and gentlemen, before you move a muscle, I want you to just do a quick audit. See how much space you are naturally taking up right now. Are you hunched over? Are your arms crossed? Are your ankles crossed? Are your legs crossed? One of my favorite authors, Veronica Ruckert, who wrote a book called Outspoken, calls this look the lady pretzel. Because so many women are conditioned our entire lives to just fold in on ourselves, sometimes very implicitly, but sometimes very explicitly. I remember my Panamanian grandmother telling me to cross my little ankles in church on Easter Sunday and put my hands on my lap and sit quietly and still. That's the archetype of a good little girl, right? Is to not take up space and to not make any noise. What are the ramifications of that conditioning if taking up less space makes young girls and women feel less powerful? That stuff adds up over time. Similarly, if we tell our boys, boys will be boys, run wild, take up all the space in the world, and we don't tell our little girls that, what messages are we sending to the little boys and ultimately men in our world about entitlement, about the ability to take up space, perhaps even at the cost of others' rights to take up space? It's not me who coined the term manspreading on public transit PSAs across the nation. This is a very real phenomenon. And while nobody is biologically wired to take up more or less space necessarily, this is a conditioning that happens to us over time that we really should question. Because as grown women and men and anyone across the gender spectrum, how we choose to take up space gives implicit permission to the little boys and girls who are watching us to determine how they should take up space as well. So let's keep in mind that standing in your power is a radical act. It sends a message to the world that says, yeah, I'm here and I belong here. And more importantly, it sends a message to yourself, which is you are here, you belong here. And it is a radical act to unapologetically take up all the space that you need in this world. Not at the cost of others' ability to take up space. That would get us over into aggressive territory. But assertively owning your power physically is super duper important.
Before we move forward, just want everyone again to think about how you can leverage this during your job search. So can you take a few minutes before your interview to do that Wonder Woman pose? Or maybe like myself, you need a little help with networking events, you know, when we're in person again. So instead of finding a seat and shrinking up, you can take up some space in a way that's confident and approachable. And hopefully that will help you seem more confident and approachable for your networking purposes.
I love that. It's such a good reminder. It's also a good reminder that the clothes that we choose to wear, we should be able to take up space in them comfortably and like stand in our power comfortably. Again, not here to give any fashion advice, but how we choose to dress ourselves should reinforce our ability to just take up space and not shrink us. So great point, Brandy. I can't wait for in-person happy hours again. Networking opportunities again. Awesome. Last point I want to make here is about vocal assertiveness. So historically, young women in the world, teenage women in particular, tend to be our society's linguistic innovators. So it's no wonder that when the rise of upspeak, which was like totally coined by the Valley Girl movement, which is beautifully exemplified by Cher in the movie Clueless, where she, you know, makes declarative sentences but ends her sentences with an upward intonation, that was a total movement started by teenage girls. So what does society think about the way that we speak when we speak with upspeak? Not good. Right? It's not a coincidence that society has deemed upspeak, which was coined by young women in particular, as not professional, as ditzy, right? As perhaps a little bit childish and dumb. Literally can make you seem less intelligent. That's the patriarchy at work, y'all. Okay, this is not a coincidence that the way young women choose to speak is deemed less worthy of listening. However wrong that may be, it's an opportunity for an empowered choice, right? For you to make an empowered choice about how you want to be perceived. So for my Californians who are tuning in, for whom upspeak is kind of a normal thing, taking the 505 to La Brea, all you have to do is Google SNL's Californians skit to watch examples of upspeak in action. This is an opportunity to recognize not everybody may perceive that vocal intonation in the way that you want to be perceived. So instead, we can practice a downward intonation, practice declarative sentences, practice ending our sentences in a downward tone. That seems pretty tricky, right? So if you have to practice that over and over again, studies have shown that adding a physiological movement, like squeezing your fist to end your sentences declaratively, or even stomping your foot a little bit, preferably not when you're on a stage giving a keynote, but just practicing on your own to get this downward intonation, a physiological matching behavior can help. I'll give one quick example. My darling mother had an outgoing voicemail message on her cell phone that said, "Hi, you've reached Kathy." And she had her upward intonation when she said her name. I was like, "Mom, it sounds like you don't know your own name. That was a declarative sentence. You got to try that one again." So know that this is very common. It slips into our everyday speech because honestly, it's just it's a colloquialism that shows our speech partners, whoever we're talking to, that we're listening and that we're continuing the thought and we're keeping it going and we're not like ending a conversation. But it doesn't play well in the interview or in the job search or in a big important business meeting. So if you've ever gotten the feedback that you say things that sound like questions, but you're not asking a question, this is something to work on to help reverse that impression. Finally, another vocal iteration we have young women, millennial women in particular, to thank for is vocal fry. Vocal fry is a low, creaky vibration that's caused by a fluttering in the vocal cords. And in fact, some speech pathologists have called it vocal abuse because it does actually do a little bit of damage to your vocal cords when you speak like that. Now, once again, the world has deemed vocal fry as annoying and not super professional. And again, I'm not here to say whether that's right or wrong. Talk however you want to talk, but knowing that studies have found that people generally are a little bit irritated by vocal fry. Again, not a coincidence. It's something we might want to adjust from an empowered choice that we can make when it best serves our interest. So if you like totally talk with vocal fry and perhaps you're a East Coaster Manhattanite where like all very upwardly mobile, very intelligent, hardworking young women talk like this in Manhattan, that's fine if that works for you. However, if you are talking to a client who might not share your demographics, you're interviewing with someone who might not share your demographics, who doesn't share your speech patterns, you might want to be aware of the fact that this can be, again, coming across in a way you don't want to come across. So how do we solve for vocal fry? It's actually very simple. All we have to do is raise our vocal octave a little bit. So get us out of the guttural gutter there by going from down here to up here. And all of a sudden, there's no friction in our vocal cords. Another alternative is to practice deep belly breathing. Any yogis in the house know what I'm talking about? More air, more oxygen can also solve for that friction in our vocal cords. I hope you're making, where I'm making it clear that I'm, again, not here to police your speech. And I don't even think it's fair that the world deems the way young women tend to iterate on, you know, linguistic innovation as less professional. But I am here to say that is the unfair world we live in. And if you'd like to do something about it, here are some tips and tricks for how to adjust. I'm going to move on to a few final notes here. I love this quote from Sheryl Sandberg's Lean In, which is not a perfect book by any means, but she makes a really important point here. You can't change what you're not aware of. But once you're aware of it, it's hard not to change.
Quote, "We cannot change what we are not aware of, and once we are aware, we cannot help but change."
So I hope I've shared a few resources with you today, a few strategies with you that you can pick and choose from. Pick whatever serves you from today's conversation and take that with you into your interview, into your negotiations, into your professional development practice. And if there are things in here that don't serve you, that feel like too much of a departure from your authentic self, leave it. And don't change the way you talk just to please people around you. I think there's something really powerful and radical about that. I also think it's a-okay to adjust the way you talk until you have power to be radical in the workplace. And I always say it's on us to play the cards we've been dealt while we change the game, to hopefully lift as we climb and make it a little easier for the women who come after us in particular. So a few key ways to showcase your assertive communication skills specific to the job search. First, on your resume, let's not shy away from listing our skills that relate to assertiveness, like practicing leadership, providing constructive feedback, managing conflict, problem solving. Those are all leadership characteristics that require assertiveness. Don't be afraid to brag about yourself in that way. Similarly, show some examples in your professional experience as to how you assertively led teams to positive outcomes, like this example here, where we aligned stakeholders to develop a new intake process through active listening and consistent communications, despite conflicting interests, resulting in on-time project delivery and 20% increase in process adoption. That's such a great example. We're not trying to hide the fact that there was conflict. We can actually showcase that there was conflict and we managed it like a boss. Similarly, in the interview, let's take some of the nonverbal and verbal practices of assertiveness that we talked about earlier today. Let's show up with a firm handshake when that's a thing in the world again soon. For now, the elbow thing we'll have to do. But let's show up with broad body language, right? Strong posture. Because if we show up caved in on ourselves with our head tilted to the side, with our voice asking questions when we're actually making statements, we are sending a strong message about how we feel about ourselves and our capabilities to do this job.
Good eye contact or looking at the camera. She points to the camera.
Maintaining good eye contact or good contact with whatever that is in the meantime can be helpful. And again, just like with the resume example, don't be afraid to give examples of you being a boss, being assertive, managing conflict, bringing diverse stakeholders together around an idea.
Respond with examples of you giving firm, clear direction.
We're not trying to say we've never had to deal with conflict or we are completely immune to disagreement. We are here to say, yeah, disagreement happens. Diverse opinions are good for us in work, but I know how to handle them and I know how to get people on board. And that's really what being a boss is all about. Finally, assertiveness in the workplace. Let's remember the personal and professional benefits of assertiveness are key here. So don't be afraid to set boundaries personally and professionally. Let's also make space for listening politely and actively to others. Because after all, being assertive doesn't mean being the loudest voice in the room. It means getting your point across and creating space for others. In fact, passing the mic by saying, Brandy, you've got some really great insights on this. Why don't you weigh in? Is a wonderful example of assertive allyship in action. Similarly, especially when you're in a leadership position or a manager, making clear, detailed requests without apology. Ooh, hey, team, data team, would you please pull a report for me that I kind of need every other Wednesday? It's not a very assertive way to say, hey, data team, in order for our marketing department to proceed as strategically as possible, we'd love to have this kind of a report produced for us every Wednesday. Is that something we could make happen? And finally, don't be afraid to be proactive about collaboration. If you see someone you've got a total career crush on, you see a prospective mentor walking through the halls at your place of work, don't be afraid to be proactive and assertive about reaching out and asking for the support that you need. All right, I know we're just about at time here. I want to recap with a few key takeaways. First, let's keep in mind that all of us, men, women, and everyone across the gender spectrum, we're all guilty of carrying unconscious gender bias. It's in the water we swim in. It is in our societal history. No matter how much we strive to be not sexist or a feminist, unconscious bias across race, gender, age, etc., is part of all of us. So we need to acknowledge that bias if we are to check it and move forward. Assertive and aggressive are fundamentally different. The more we can point this out for ourselves and our colleagues, the more likely assertive women are to be seen as leaders, not as shrill or naggy or bossy. In fact, calling this difference out can be a really helpful act of allyship when you see an assertive woman who's deemed less likable in a way that perhaps a man who is being assertive wouldn't be deemed less likable. As I mentioned earlier, there are some major benefits of being assertive, both personally and professionally. But being well-liked by everyone all the time is unfortunately not a byproduct, I can promise here. It's just not a guarantee, right? We have to be okay with some people sometimes not liking us, which is really hard for many of us, women especially, who've been taught our self-worth hinges on others' perceptions of ourselves. But that is, in fact, part of being a leader, right? Being willing to take risks, being tolerant of the upsides and the downsides of speaking your mind and saying this project needs to change drastically if we are to move forward is part of being a leader. It's part of being a boss. So I hope that you can take these skills with you in your practice of leadership on behalf of yourself and others. Now, if you liked what you heard today, I would love, like I said at the top, to remain friends. Let's keep in touch.
Text, learn more from Bossed Up. BossedUp.org/letschat.
You can learn a lot more about the offerings that we have at my company, Bossed Up. I wanted to offer you all a totally free consultation with myself or a member of the Bossed Up team if you're interested in learning more about any of our programs. For our leveling up leaders who are looking to be more assertive and practicing their leadership and really honing their management skills, check out Level Up, our leadership accelerator. For my job seekers here, we have a one-of-its-kind 3-month job search accelerator called Hired, which I'm delighted to be leading right now, which has had some tremendously positive results for clients even throughout this pandemic who are landing jobs, landing opportunities, and really assertively being proactive in their job search process. And if you're someone here who's listening to all of this, who's thinking about how am I ever going to be able to speak up like this in a meeting? How am I ever going to be able to speak my mind with my clients? Or how am I ever going to navigate what Brandy was mentioning, the post-pandemic networking happy hours again? Check out Speak Up, our, again, one of its kind public speaking program that I lead that is such a fun part of my job in refining all of our speech patterns to really be as conscientious, cogent, effective communicators as possible. Again, if you'd like to learn more, we're always happy to hop on a totally free consultation. Just go to bossedup.org/letschat and sign up for a call time so we can talk through how we can support you. Brandy, thank you so much for making time for today. I'm so delighted to be here again. I love working with Indeed, and I'm so delighted to take your questions next.
Thanks, Emilie.
Time for Q&A.
So let's get into some of the questions. first, I worry the pause will make me look unprepared or the person will wonder what's taking me so long. Emilie, any thoughts on that?
Such a great question and a common misconception. So silence, there's research that shows this. Silence is correlated with power or perception of power, meaning for folks who are using silence comfortably in their conversations, they are actually more likely to be seen as powerful, confident, and thoughtful. It feels like an eternity to you because you're the one who's thinking, oh my God, what am I going to say next? But what might feel like an eternity to you is really usually not that long for someone else. I would wait to ask for feedback if that feels too uncomfortable for you. So once you start getting feedback that your pauses are too long and a little halting, then perhaps there's something to it. But think about President Barack Obama. He was sort of notorious as someone who used a lot of pause in his everyday speech. And, you know, he was parodied for it for sure from some, but it was also a way to project authority and power. Contrast that with leaders who speak more quickly, who, like I just did there, who use nonverbal filler words to bridge the gap between one word and the next. And research shows time and time again, silence is seen as a better alternative. So, you know, I would say practice by recording yourself and then playing your own video back to see if it does actually take as much time as you think, or if it's just anxiety in your own mind about it.
Here's the next question. As a person of color, how do you prevent being considered aggressive when you're being assertive?
Great question. Just like women of all shades, really, it's never fully in our control. So I want to be clear here. When I talk about intersectionality and unconscious bias, sure, there's some things we can do to try to hack into the very biased, unconscious perceptions that other people have of us, but it is by no means entirely within our control. So we have to give ourselves a little bit of a break here. We got to cut ourselves some slack. We have to acknowledge that while we can do all of these strategies and employ all of these communication strategies that I'm sharing here, it's never a guarantee that we can hack into other people's unconscious biases and turn, you know, a historically really unfair situation to a neutral one. And that's all we're asking for. So every tip I shared today is designed to help you navigate that. But at the end of the day, it's never fully within our control. So I think we as women, and especially for women of color and other marginalized communities, always also need what the Harvard Business Review calls a safe identity workspace, where we can come together with people who get it, with people who share our experiences, with people who will validate the challenges that you face, and where you can be yourself and not worry about having to put a mask on and you know, adjust your style to please other people. But it's exhausting. There's a lot of emotional labor involved in all of this. So I would employ all the strategies I shared today to try to do that, but also know that it's never perfectly within your control.
Yeah, and I just want to give everyone a heads up that we did just do a job cast on racial bias in the job search and in the hiring process.
Job cast, beat the bias. go.indeed.com/beat the bias.
So that might be something worthwhile to check out, and we'll post that in the chat. Here's a question I think a lot of us can relate to. How can women ensure that their kindness is not seen as weakness and or prevent coworkers or employers from getting the impression that they can be taken advantage of? The example here is, I've been elected to deal with difficult people over male coworkers because I'm more patient. Or I simply end up having to do more work than others when called on to help because I struggle to say no due to worry that folks will perceive me as unhelpful or not a team player.
Yeah, such a great point. So first, there's a really interesting study that comes out of Columbia Business School, that shows such helping activities are seen as completely expected for women and do not result in women's professional accolades or reviews being any better for women who don't when compared to women who don't do those kinds of extracurricular office housework. When men volunteer to take on difficult people, to lead the party planning committee, to do the office housework that so often falls to women, men are accoladed and rewarded and literally are given higher reviews because they're seen as going above and beyond. So ladies, let's give men the opportunity to step up because we're not actually getting any brownie points for doing it. So we have to start saying no. It's hard for sure, but we have to start saying no because we don't want to rob our male colleagues of this opportunity to be seen as super helpers. So first of all, do yourself a favor by saying no to these opportunities more often. It's not going to hurt you because it's already not helping you. And I would say it's not going to hurt you as much as you might think because it's probably not helping your cause and your professional advancement at all. But also, we have to share that burden with men. Gentlemen listening, we have to audit who's doing the office housework. I created a course with LinkedIn Learning. I just shared it on my LinkedIn profile yesterday because it's been unlocked. It's been made free throughout Women's History Month starting yesterday. And the course is called How to Be a Male Ally at Work. And I walk through a lot of different strategies, but particularly this one on office housework, for men to share the burdens that women disproportionately carry at work. So to my question asker, I say, your experience is far too common. You're shouldering a bunch of labor that's not helping your professional advancement at all. And the only person who can draw boundaries for yourself on this is you. Nobody else is going to save the day for you here. So as difficult as it might be, I hope the strategies we talked about today give you some new ways to approach saying no. And I highly recommend volunteering someone else in the office to step up, particularly a man who's more likely to get accolades for actually stepping up in this way anyway.
Thanks, Emily. This last question is actually from a man. As a 61-year-old white man, when I try to be assertive, it can sometimes be seen as being in dad mode, which not only intimidates, but can also turn off others. Suggestions?
I have never heard that before, so I appreciate this person for speaking up and sharing. Dad mode. That is so interesting. I'm a little tickled by this because I hear from women all the time that they're called marms or nags or like they're being the office mom by simply being assertive and acting like a leader. I've never heard a man say they're called being the office dad. So in some ways, this is kind of a terrible win for gender equality in that nobody should be patronized in this way. Nobody should be called a dad or a mom for being a boss. So that's one for starters. That being said, sometimes you're going to be intimidating. Men and women, when you're being assertive, some people will be intimidated by you. That doesn't mean you're being intimidating. That means other people are intimidated. And again, we can do the best we can to lead with intent before getting to content, which will help buffer that. But we can't be the emotional therapist of everybody in the office. We can't do it. It's too much work. It's not in our job description unless you are a therapist. So again, being a leader means being willing to risk being seen as the office dad. If you are standing up for the good of the client, for the good of the company, for the good of the team, that's being a leader. Nobody said being a leader means being popular with everyone all the time. So we have to detach our sense of success with everyone being happy with our every decision. I think that's the difference between being respected as a leader and being liked as a leader. My very first podcast episode, episode one, and I'm at, 300 something. My very first podcast episode is called To Lead or Be Liked. And I interviewed Sarah Green Carmichael, who was at the time one of the editors-in-chief at the Harvard Business Review. And we talked all about this lifelong conundrum that leaders of all stripes face. You know, speaking up and dissenting or speaking up assertively in any capacity doesn't guarantee that you're going to win any popularity contests. But I would hope that we're speaking up and we're taking those risks because our leadership is called upon. to do so. And to say nothing would be negligent. To sit idly by and allow injustice to happen in any form is why we have business school case studies like Enron, right? That's why big organizations that employ tons of people who are all complicit in bad behavior get studied, right? And we as humans are very compliant. And there's some really fascinating social science that shows people follow orders even against their own moral compass. So to the dad of the office, I would say sometimes being a good boss is like being a good parent. You got to draw boundaries for yourself and for others to stand up for what your organization or what your team believes in terms of values, because values are violated often. And saying nothing means abdicating your responsibility as a leader. So it's an imperfect answer for a very imperfect situation, but I'll end it there, hopefully giving you permission to proceed assertively, despite whatever the critics might call you behind your back. This is not a popularity contest, and that's rarely where the best leaders emerge from.
Yeah, and I'd just add there that as long as you're being careful about leaving space for others' opinions and feelings to be heard, and you're not being aggressive and just, you know, voicing over all of them what you feel, then I think that all of these topics or all of the tips that Emilie covered are still super applicable, no matter whether, you know, what gender you are. If you found this to be helpful, check out our other jobcasts at indeed.com/jobcast. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and comment below. Thanks for watching.
Text Jobcast by Indeed